Oh. Good afternoon, everybody. It's Elaine Lindsay of Business Banter Plus, and I'm here with the lovely Melonie Dodaro. I want to welcome you to the show. Hi, Melonie. Thanks very much for being here.
Hi, Elaine.
It's good to see you out on the West Coast, another Canadian. Very nice to have you. I want to give you guys just a sort of a quick rundown because there's so much about Melonie, we'd have to do a five-hour show, I think, to touch on everything. So I'm just going to start with the fact that she's Canada's number one LinkedIn expert. She founded her company, Top Dog Social Media, with the vision of helping business owners and professionals master the often confusing world of social media marketing. Isn't that the truth? She's received a number of awards, Best Online Marketer 2013, their top finalists for Small Business BC, the Best Social Marketing Media Marketing Company for 2012 by Promotion World, kudos to you, and the top 24 social media blogs in 2012 from Social Media Examiner. Those are just a few things that I'll touch on. I will also say that Melonie is a wonderful speaker. I was lucky enough to share the stage with her in Las Vegas at the Big Social Summit last October, and she's also done Social Media Camp Victoria, TOTA, which is the Thompson Okanagan Tourism Association, and is going to be one of the speakers on the Big Social Cruise coming up in September, heading off to Alaska. Welcome. As I said before, it's wonderful to have you here, Melonie. I just want to talk to you about your passions. And before we get into that, I want to say to people, Melanie's had a really interesting road to get to where she is now. So I think you're going to find this a really interesting interview.
It's been not only an interesting road, a very painful road.
Absolutely. And you know?
Well, like it is for, I'm sure, many business owners that are just overwhelmed and confused. That was me 6 years ago, completely overwhelmed, completely confused, kind of coming into this online world. And I've had a lot of very expensive lessons along the way, a lot of pain along the way.
And, isn't that what they say, that the magic comes out of the pain?
Yeah, yeah. I wish it would have been a little less expensive, though.
Absolutely, absolutely. So take us on a tour of Melonie and how you got here.
Yeah, so for most of my life, I've been an entrepreneur. So I used to own a number of different businesses. They were all brick-and-mortar businesses. And in 2007, I wrote a book. And at the same time, most of my family lived out in the Toronto area, and I had moved out to BC in 2004. So I don't know if most people know this, but back, I don't know what the stats are today in terms of demographics, but in 2007, Toronto was the number one city per capita in the world for Facebook users. So all my family was on it, and they kept saying, Mel, you got to get on this Facebook. I'm like, what in the world is this stupid Facebook? And I was very, very anti-social media. I was also a very, very private person. And I never wanted to be in the public eye in any way. I didn't even want anything online about me. And this comes back from, you know, my younger years. I had a difficult situation when I was in my early 20s with a stalker and stuff like that. So I was such a private person. And when I got on Facebook, I only allowed my family and, like, my best friends to be my friends. Anybody else that would send me a friend request, I'd hit deny, ignore, block, whatever. And it was a couple months in that I started to really see the business opportunity that was available on Facebook. I didn't know what it looked like yet, but I saw the opportunity.
Yeah.
And having been an entrepreneur for so long, my mind always thinks business. And so I started kind of playing with it. I thought this might be a great platform for me to promote my book. You know, having a ton of experience in owning businesses and lots of marketing experience with traditional marketing, TV, radio, newspaper, all that, I knew that that wasn't going to be a viable solution for promoting a $20 book.
Yeah.
So I thought, wow, maybe this online stuff is going to work. Anyway, so it set me on my journey to learn absolutely everything that I could about online marketing and social media, and it was a very painful journey. I'm a very non-techie person. So people assume because I know social media that I'm techie, and in fact, I guess today I'm probably 100 times more techie than I was 6 years ago, but yeah. I'm still not a techie person. So, and as Elaine knows, this is my first Google Hangout because this is a little too techie for me.
And you've done really well getting in and everything. So.
But after today, that will probably all change. So, as I was learning and going through this process of paying a whole bunch of different people to coach and mentor me and attending seminars and reading books and all that, bang my head against the wall over and over and over again, waste money, you know, it was just a big long process because the thing is not a lot of people really understood how to use social media for business at that time. So my big question was, how do you use social media profitably? Right? Not just properly, but profitably. And it took me 3 years to figure out that answer.
Oh, absolutely.
So after I figured out the answer, I started having a lot of business owners contacting me and saying, hey, Melanie, I just love what you're doing on Facebook or Twitter or LinkedIn or whatever. Can you give me some pointers? I'm like, absolutely. Of course I can. And I was giving away free advice left and right, and I loved it. I really loved it. And I was like, wow, I think I've had a little bit of a passion shift here. It might be time for a change. And so that's how my company, Top Dog Social Media, got started.
Awesome.
So it was quite an evolution.
Well, it is, as we know, once we really get passionate about social, it really does turn everything else on its head.
Yeah, and see, you know, I'm a little different than I think most of the social media people out there. I don't really love the social aspect of social media. Like in terms of, you know, I don't spend tons of time on it each day talking and playing and stuff like that. I'm really much more focused and diligent in how I use it. And of course I am social on it. And of course I do, you know, communicate, build relationships on it. But I really look at it more from a business perspective and try not to waste a lot of time because social media can be a huge time suck.
Oh, absolutely. People, if you play games at all, not a gamer, I just don't have the coordination for it, thank God, because it really does absolutely suck time.
Yeah, I mean, I've never downloaded any of those different things on Facebook, the Farmville and all these different games that people play. I don't have anything against people that like and use it for that kind of enjoyment. It's just for me, it's not there. And that's what actually really got me interested in LinkedIn.
Right.
Because I always say to people that I'm a business owner first. I'm an entrepreneur first and a social media person second.
Right.
So I look at everything through business eyes. And that's what attracted me to LinkedIn because it's all business. People aren't talking about what they had for lunch. You know, they're not playing games. It's all business, right? So it gravitated to my personality style. And I also, you know, see a lot more results in it for, you know, the types of clients that I work with and, of course, for myself. So it's been really great for that. I think that there's great aspects to all the different social networks that are out there, and I think that they all have their place, and they're all a little different.
Absolutely. And as we both know, you go where your audience is. And,
yes.
And, you know, for different people, that's definitely different platforms. The one thing that I have found out in the latest surveys and information is it's almost become a faux pas to not be on LinkedIn. If you're a professional, you need to be on LinkedIn.
Absolutely.
Bottom line.
And not only be on LinkedIn, but have a great presence. Because
exactly.
It's your professional presence. And one of the things that I say to people a lot is, you know, if you're a professional, if you're a professional services person where your business is you. You're not a restaurant or a carpet cleaner or something like that. Your business is you. People are going to do Google searches.
Absolutely.
And LinkedIn has really powerful Google indexing, as does Google Plus. Yeah. And so your LinkedIn profile shows up at the top of the search results. So it's often your very first impression. So I always say to people, are you happy with the first impression that you're making online right now? Does it look good? Does it convey the message that you want to convey? Does it attract the clients that you want to attract?
Yeah, and I think that's a really good point. Something I also just read actually was all of the Fortune 500 companies, every single one of them are now on LinkedIn, yeah. And 83% of all top-level decision makers use LinkedIn first, yeah, which I think is incredible.
Well, the other thing about, there's a couple of things that are really great about LinkedIn. One is that people are 2 times more likely to trust what they read on LinkedIn than any other social network. And it's 4 times more effective for B2B, so business to business.
Absolutely.
Get Facebook or Twitter. So yeah, it depends again, who is your market? If you're a restaurant or a retail store, Facebook and Twitter are definitely, great options. But if you're B2B or you're a professional of any kind, LinkedIn is definitely a place that not only do you need to be there, you need to look great there, and you need to spend some time there.
And I think that's a really important point. It's not enough to be there.
Right.
I have actually counseled people that are restaurants. After we were together in Las Vegas, I decided that it was really, really important that I take everything you had offered us, which was quite a bit, and really not just implement it for myself, but like you, I just love to help other people. As you know, I'm forever Google Plusing everybody wherever I go. But I had spoken to some restaurateurs and basically said, this is a great way for you to be contacting your suppliers. Make sure that you're connected to the people that you circulate with, that are, important to your restaurant. Pool owners, all of these people have the ability to connect to their suppliers and not just worry about getting, your customer, but being in touch with those that you need to be in touch with. That is your primary area, is definitely LinkedIn.
Yeah, that's a great point, Elaine, because, a lot of people think that they should just use it to attract customers, but there's some other reasons that you might want to be on some of these platforms, LinkedIn in particular. So, for example, when I'm consulting with a B2C, a business-to-consumer type client, I'm saying, LinkedIn can still be a good source for you, but it's going to be used a little differently.
Yes.
So, there's some different things that you might use it for. For some of the B2B people, I'll talk about, here's some other ways that you can be using it. Don't just use it to find clients. Use it to find strategic alliances. Use it to build relationships with potential referral partners. If you're a financial advisor, for example, search and network and connect with lawyers and accountants that can refer business your way. It's great. So for me, I use it for a number of different things. I connect with different people for, speaking opportunities.
Absolutely.
People that are potential joint venture partners for me, that, we might want to do some reciprocal stuff. They promote one of my courses, I promote one of theirs.
Absolutely.
So there's a tremendous amount of opportunities that a lot of times are overlooked.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And there's a lot of, now I'm finding bigger corporations are actually approaching people on LinkedIn to attend their conferences, and much more than they ever were before, and finding people through LinkedIn search.
Yeah, and LinkedIn's got a tremendous advanced search tool that you can find, pretty much anybody that you want to find in a specific geographic area, a specific type of country, company or industry.
Yeah.
There's so many variables that are available to you. Some of them are through a paid membership, and others are available through the free membership.
Yeah, and there is quite a plethora of things available, even at the free level.
Absolutely.
Which is really important, especially for very small business, when people are just starting out, brands are just beginning to be known. This is a really good way to put all your information out there, for sure. Something I wanted to, you could probably expand on for people, is exactly how to deal with your headline. This is something that's always, I see them and think, oh, wow. Melonie, take it away, because this is awesome.
So one of the things that I always say when I'm talking about LinkedIn, whether I'm doing I'm speaking somewhere, or I'm doing a training or a webinar or whatever it is that your LinkedIn profile is the foundation for your success on LinkedIn. So you need to lay the foundation first. You need to choose the keywords that you want to be found for, right? And then you need to place them in various spots throughout your profile. So your headline is the most important part of your LinkedIn profile. The reason is, is if somebody's doing a search for what it is you offer on LinkedIn, this is a qualified, hot prospect looking for exactly what you offer. And if you're not showing up at the top of the search results, you're missing out on that opportunity. But here's the thing, even if you are showing up at the top of the search results because you've optimized your profile, but the profile doesn't really speak to or engage or attract, still a lost opportunity. Mm-hmm. So your headline next to your photo and your name is the very first thing that people are going to see. So your headline needs to be compelling. It needs to grab attention, and it also needs to incorporate one or two of your keywords in there. So instead of just, you know, a lot of people will have, if they're an owner or founder of a company, they'll put, I'm the owner and founder. Yeah. Or they might put, I'm owner and founder of XYZ company. Nobody cares about that.
No, that's not what they're looking for, is it?
No, so you need to be speaking to the actual needs and grab the attention of the people that can utilize and benefit from the services or the products that you offer. And so, you know, you're very limited in characters. You've got 120 characters with your headline. And so what you need to think about is, how can I create a compelling, attention-grabbing statement and incorporate one or two of my keywords? Now, you can either incorporate the keywords right in that compelling statement, or you can put them at the tail end of it, as long as they're there, because there's several sections within a LinkedIn profile that are weighted heavily in LinkedIn's algorithm, meaning who's going to show up at the top of the search results for us non-techie people. Are you part of
algorithm? That was really well said.
I know. It's so funny. I have a 25-year-old son, and he used to make fun of me all the time because he just thought I was just a complete moron. I didn't know how to do anything with my computer. If something changed, I would be freaking out and getting him to fix it. And then as the years went by and I started studying this stuff, he would still talk to me like I was a moron.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, I'd start talking over his head. And he'd be like, what? Right. I'm more advanced than him now.
Yeah. Don't you love when that happens? Yeah, I have a 31-year-old, one of those, who used to think he was way ahead. But I'm slightly more techie than you, I would say. But
Yeah,
he was a gamer from way back. So it's nice to surpass them once in a while. That's to let them know you're still viable.
Yeah. He's like, really? Did you just say that?
Oh, my God, yeah. Well, something that actually ties into that, and it's not specific to LinkedIn, but when you're found on Google in search, you should really have a description that's about 12 or 13 words so that it fits. With Google Plus and authorship, you actually have a little more space now. But keeping that in mind, that headline on LinkedIn is a bang-on prospect for what you want in your description.
Yeah, and here's the other thing, too, is sometimes, and you can't control this because this is now we're talking about Google,
yes,
but sometimes your LinkedIn profile will show up on page one of Google when somebody's searching for the keywords that are within your LinkedIn profile.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that was part of, I was looking about 6 months ago at the headlines after we had talked and changed a few things, and I realized that within that 12 or 13 word capacity, the headline would fit very well and actually give you, rather than having your sentence cut off or your description cut off, it's really specific to who you are and what you do.
Yeah.
And that's strictly for search there.
Yeah, so the headline clearly is the most important part because it's what's going to make people click on your profile.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if they click on your profile looks like crap, you're going to lose them.
Yeah, yeah.
So you need to spend some time and, you know, write through your profile. One of the things that is a huge misconception for most people is they think that their LinkedIn profile should be their online resume.
Yeah.
That's kind of the way it's been positioned.
Mm-hmm.
Which is absolutely true if you're a job seeker.
Yes.
If you're a job seeker, do it that way. But if you are using LinkedIn as a business building tool, you have to use it differently. Which means you have to speak to who your client is. I always say that your LinkedIn profile should be client focused, not you focused. So when you go to my LinkedIn profile, you'll see about this much of me and the rest of it speaking to you know, who I want to attract, right?
Yeah.
So it's really important to make sure that that it's really speaking to who you want to be attracting.
Absolutely, absolutely. Because you really want to touch on those pain points so that it's very obvious to the clients that are requiring your services that you're the person for them?
I would say that basically when somebody lands on your profile, if they are an ideal client, they should immediately be able to self-select.
Absolutely.
Say, this is a person I need to connect with. This is a person I need to talk to.
Absolutely.
This person can solve this very painful problem that I have right now.
Yeah. Yeah, that's exactly my point. And that making sure that your profile is complete, I think is really important in LinkedIn. It's important in Google+. But for any business owner who really wants to make a good showing, wherever you are, wherever your audience is, that should also be complete. If it's not one of the big ones, then you need to apply that wherever else you are, because I think this speaks to best practices, and that's important.
Yeah, absolutely. The completion of the profile is very important. And in LinkedIn, they actually have a little tool that will show you, you know, where you are along the process. Are you at 50%, 70%, 90%, 100%? I always say that when you're at 100% in LinkedIn's eyes, you're at 40% in mine.
Well said.
Because here's the thing. All you have to do is write your title and your company name, and you don't even need to fill out any description at all for you to have that part completed. But it's not completed. It's not telling anybody anything about you or what you offer or what you do. So just because you've entered in those two fields means nothing.
Good. And that's exactly the point I wanted to get to, because often, when you see those things and you think, okay, I've done the bare minimum, it's not the bare minimum. It's do what you expect others to do if you were going to look for them.
Yeah.
Because if you put yourself in that mindset.
No, absolutely. I literally will spend between 8 and 10 hours. When somebody hires me to write a LinkedIn profile for them, I'll spend 8 to 10 hours. Combination of doing some research about who their ideal client is, what kind of language is important to them, what kind of problems are important to them, and really speak to and write it that way, as well as figure out, what are the right keywords, optimize every square inch of the profile, fill out every single section of the profile, almost to its capacity. So, for example, in your summary section, it allows you to fill out, you can put 2,000 characters in there. I usually max out those 2,000 characters. Yes. I usually write 3,000 characters and then have to come back
and edit it out.
Yeah, because the more content you have in your LinkedIn profile, the more likely you are to show up.
Absolutely.
If you don't have enough content in there, you're not going to show up.
That's so true. So very true. Mm-hmm. And let's go back to for 1 minute to noting that there is a very big difference between business owners on LinkedIn and job seekers on LinkedIn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I mean, for a job seeker, a more resume-style profile is suitable. As soon as that person gets a job, and if their job involves anything where, networking with other people becomes important, or building relationships with other people becomes important, or finding potential clients or prospects, then they need to tweak it to start to speak to that. But if they're looking for a job, it's okay to have it resume kind of bio style, because they don't have an ideal client they're trying to attract. They are trying to attract an ideal employer, though. And so I don't very often do LinkedIn profiles for job seekers, just simply because they usually can't afford me.
Right, right.
They're unemployed, right? But I have done a few. And so what I'll do that's very different from what anybody else would do is I'll actually speak to the ideal employers that they're looking to attract. And here's another super sneaky little ninja trick. I'll actually write the names of the companies that they want to work for in there.
Oh, wow.
I'll be like, I'm seeking a position with, these types of companies in these types of positions. So I'll optimize their profile for all of the different positions that they want to get filled for. So recently I did it for a hotel manager. He was a very experienced hotel manager who, the hotel he was working for got sold. He was in a position where he had to look for a new job. So I was like, okay, what are all the companies you want to work for?
Yeah.
And I would incorporate all of those names his thing. I'm like, what are all the different positions that they might be looking for? You could be a general manager, you could be a hotel manager, you could be a sales manager, you know what I mean?
Operation.
And so I incorporated all that into his profile. He found a job.
Oh, that's excellent, Melonie. That's really, really good and very key. because there are a lot of people out there that are looking for jobs and starting to understand just how viable and how important LinkedIn is for them, and that's really important.
Yeah.
Let's move on to like a little broader in LinkedIn. I'd like to get your impressions of groups.
LinkedIn groups are gold mines, right? If you use them properly.
Yeah.
So here's the thing, is every single person that I know when I'm first talking to them, they'll, you know, a lot of them will have joined groups. So for example, the financial advisor will have joined all the financial advisor groups.
Yeah.
The realtor will have joined all the realtor groups.
Yeah.
I'm like, no, you join groups based on where your ideal clients are. So if you are, you know, a local business within a city, you might want to join all the local groups that are related to the city. If you have a specific type of client that you work with, you know, maybe you work with coaches and consultants or speakers or trainers, or maybe you work with accountants, or maybe you work with professional services people, then join those groups.
Yes.
And start to interact and engage in those groups and provide value. That is the key. Provide value within these groups. Don't be a spammer. So much spam on social media. It's really ridiculous. It's very disappointing because it over time starts to get people to start to ignore more and more, right?
It does.
I report everybody for spam.
Thank you. I wanted to get your opinion on that. Yeah, I think it's important. And this is something I used to say to my parents a lot was, you know, if you go to a restaurant and the food is bad or the waitress was terrible or you go to a store and you get shoddy merchandise, they can't fix the problem unless they know there's a problem. So if you don't report these people, we're just going to be more and more inundated with spam because nobody's saying anything.
Exactly. So no, I always report. There's a lot of people that will set up fake accounts.
Yeah.
And some signs to look for is they'll have, okay, so there was this happened last year where there was a plethora of this where there was very attractive, very beautiful women pictures with, you know, sales at Nike. And they put these high-end companies like IBM, Hewlett-Packard, Apple, you know, all these big name companies, these really beautiful women pictures, there would be nothing in their profile.
Yeah.
And so, and it would be one after another after another. I would open up my LinkedIn profile and I'd have like 100 requests from all these things. And so literally I just went spam, 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 spam. Because that's all they were. They weren't even real profiles. So
absolutely. Absolutely. And that's another thing. There's now a new the little templates that people, when you just click and connect, there's a new one. It's because you're a person I trust. I'm almost at the point where I see that, and it's like, I'm sorry, I'm not going to connect with you because, A, you don't know me, and so why do you trust me? That makes no sense to me.
My number one message to everybody when it comes to any kind of interaction or engagement on LinkedIn is personalize, personalize, personalize. Do not ever, ever, ever use a default message through LinkedIn. Connection request, recommendation request, anything. Always personalize your message. If you don't know that person and you want to connect with them for whatever reason, tell them. Say, hey, you know what, we haven't met yet, but I wanted to connect with you because of XYZ. And then also say, hey, listen, if you're not comfortable with connecting, don't worry, just click ignore.
Yeah.
And let them know that, hey, you know, I want you to feel comfortable with this. If you're not, just click ignore. Some people, see, the problem with LinkedIn is that a lot of people don't understand what it's for. It's a business social network. So a lot of people are very guarded with their LinkedIn profiles. They're like, I'm not letting, kind of like me 6 years ago with Facebook.
Yeah.
I don't know this person. I'm not connecting with this person. And what I always tell people is LinkedIn's not Facebook. Facebook's where you share your personal information. LinkedIn's where you're trying to grow your business. So it's okay to connect with strangers. You don't necessarily want to connect with, you know, people that might look shady or, you know, people that might look spammy or whatever. But if the person looks legit, they look, you know, professional and whatnot, there's no reason not to connect with them.
Absolutely.
Because here's the thing about LinkedIn is every time you make a connection, it's a win-win. So you and I connect on LinkedIn, Elaine. Now you are exposed to my very large network on LinkedIn that just massively increased your second and third level connections.
Absolutely.
By millions and millions and millions. And however many people you have, it doesn't even matter, you've exposed me to your network and second and third level connections, so we both helped each other by connecting.
Absolutely.
What people don't realize is that you only show up in a LinkedIn search when people are doing searches for what you offer if you're in the first, second, or third level network.
Yeah.
So if you have such a small network or you're restricting things, you're missing out on opportunities because you're not showing up in the search results.
And I say to people who are a bit hesitant or just starting out, bottom line, I think you need to have a minimum of 501 in your network before you're going to be able to utilize this at all. Because it's that outreach, it's that amplification.
Yes.
That, because you and I, we don't know. It could be, your best friend's brother-in-law's second neighbor that wants to connect through how it works.
Right.
We don't know. It's not always the person that's connecting to us that wants to work with us.
Oh, absolutely. I was actually just talking to a friend of mine today that, also Deb White.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
We were having a conversation on the phone, and she was talking about, getting out and networking a little bit more for her business. And we were talking about networking, and I was saying, here's the thing about networking that people don't realize is, when you're out and speaking to people, every single person you speak to doesn't have to be a prospect for you.
No.
But when you impress them with, who you are and what you know, when they're speaking to somebody else that needs what you offer, they're going to remember you. And a perfect example is I just had a guy contact me yesterday who's a friend of a friend.
Yeah.
And the friend, who unfortunately has passed away, he passed away last year, my friend, who was a mutual friend of ours, but he had promoted me like crazy to this guy, who now just got hired in with a new company, and they were sitting down having a meeting, the company owner and key stakeholders within the company, and they were talking about, we need a social media presence, we should hire. And this friend of a friend of mine said, we need to hire, Melonie Dodaro from Top Dog Social Media. And he said, everybody in the meeting was like, oh, but I know a social media person. Oh, I know a social media person. Oh, I know a social media person. But he had such strong belief in me. And then what he did, it was funny. He said, I pulled up your website and I played your video and everybody just stopped talking. They're like, okay. He sold me. He sold me. And I had never even had a conversation with the owner. And then this morning he called me, same guy. Melonie, I have a referral for you. Somebody in Calgary, here's her phone number, contact her, she wants to hire you. Yeah. So other people can be great, promoters of you. And so many of these relationships I've created online, you can create them online, you can create them offline.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that kind of brand advocacy is ideally where you're trying to go.
Yeah.
That is the point. You want your great customers to become your great brand advocates.
Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely.
And not even your customers.
Not your connections, shall we say.
Connections. Yeah. Obviously your customers are great because they've had a personal experience with you, but other people that know you and really kind of, saw through, who you were and the message that you had and saw a great potential for you to help, one of their friends or families or co-workers or colleagues or business acquaintances or whatever, it's a great opportunity.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I had the same thing happen. I met a woman at a networking event and we had talked and it was great, but she recommended me to another group to come and do a speak for them because she got what I was talking about, which I hadn't met her before that.
Yeah.
No, it was, it's great how that works for sure. And do you belong to networks, IRL, as we say, in real life?
In real life, a little bit. I'm a member of a number of different local organizations.
Yeah.
I'm on the board of directors for several of them. And so, my business is at a place where it's much beyond where I live.
Yes.
So, I definitely get business from it, but I look at it kind of more as my community service kind of thing.
Absolutely.
I'm a member of Rotary, for example. I love Rotary, but my Rotary Club is filled with 80 to 90-year-old men.
Oh, wow.
So sometimes I do networking for other reasons. For me, when I go to Rotary, it's my feel-good time.
Yeah.
These guys are, I always say, I'm like, I've never, you know, I'm in a group. Every Tuesday when I go to these meetings, I'm in a group of the most amazing, kindest, nicest people that I know, and I leave just feeling really good.
Oh, yeah.
So they were all very, very successful business owners that have, you know, since retired and sold their businesses and whatnot. But yeah, I mean, you know, networking in real life is really where it's at. And one of the things that I always talk to people about with social media is a wonderful place to start to build relationships, but the real magic happens when you take that relationship offline.
Absolutely.
You know, can't always do that because I've got clients, you know, in the U.S., I've got clients overseas in Australia and Europe, which I may or may not ever meet. But, you know, even video really adds that extra element,
yep.
right? Those clients that you can't meet, I'm a little shy on video.
We're working on that. You're doing such a great job here.
I had three interviews this morning, back to back. I was on CTV Edmonton this morning, right before this.
Oh, excellent.
And the one after that, I said, you know, I don't like to put on makeup very often, so I put all my video stuff all in
back
one
to back
morning,
to
back to back.
Well, now see, that's efficiency. That is absolute efficiency.
Yeah, first day of the week putting makeup on, so.
Well, it's true. I find that, you know, video, because I'm such a proponent of Google Plus, and but the whole concept of video chats, this is a great way. It is, to me, the next best thing to being there.
No question.
Yeah, over time, it's actually proven in Google Plus and even people in Facebook and in some instances in LinkedIn as well. When you come to know people well enough, when you've spent enough time in video chats with people, you want to meet them in real life.
Absolutely.
You want to make that extra connection.
Oh, no question about it. I just attended social media camp in that's where I'm speaking next week, social media marketing world in San Diego a couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
And it was interesting because I had so many people that have been connected to me online and following me online. They're like, Melonie, I need to meet you when we're there. And like all these people like just reached out to actually have that real life in person.
Yeah. It's I was at an event last night, same thing, with people that, you know, I'm connected to all around North America, and it's great to be able to finally get to touch them, if you will, you know, have that touch, because it makes your next interactions all that sweet, more sweet.
I think that social media has really, in some ways, negatively affected that in people's minds, that they think that they can just create relationships online, and they've forgotten about the importance of offline.
Yeah.
They've forgotten about the importance of, you know, taking your relationship to the next level.
Yeah.
And it's really important to realize that, you know, social media is the ultimate tool for, you know, building those relationships and building that that presence much larger than you ever could have before. But as soon, whenever you have that opportunity to take that relationship to the next level, whether it's picking up the phone, calling that person, or doing a video chat like this, or meeting in real life in person, it's really important. An example of that is I had a guy that I was working with. He lived in one of my clients. He lived in Calgary. And we got him a lead for his business from one of the news anchors on the local TV show, great lead, through Twitter.
Yeah.
And we sent him the lead, and he emails me back and says, Melonie, should I like DM them, direct message them, or tweet them back? I'm like, no.
Oh.
Pick up the phone.
Oh, yeah.
Lead here.
Yeah, and that's a really, really good point. The fact that we have the opportunity for all these points of touch.
Yeah.
It's like, don't leave anything out. And and you and I come from the relationship marketing aspect, where I believe, and I know you do as well, it's about community. It's not just about the social media, the back and forth. It's about building your community.
Yeah, I mean, and relationships only move to the next level when you take them to the next level, right? You can just be Facebook friends or Twitter friends or
absolutely
forever and never really move that relationship forward.
Yeah.
So, you know, whether it's a phone call or – it was interesting. I had a guy that I connected with on LinkedIn, and I'm starting to get you know, dedicate a certain amount of time each week to just nurture and grow new relationships that are prospects. They're, you know, possible alliances and connections,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And it was so amazing. We had this conversation yesterday. We know all the same people.
Yeah.
And I was just like, wow, this world is just so unbelievably small. When you have that commonality with people, right? When you've
Absolutely.
Got something in common with them, we've got the same friends, we've got the same network. Who do you think the next time he has a conversation with somebody that says, I need somebody to help me with social media, he's going to be mentioning?
Absolutely.
That wasn't my intention. That wasn't
no,
my intention.
No,
at all.
No, no.
My intention is just to get to know him, learn
yeah.
a little bit about his business, find out what he does, and see if, you know, there's ever somebody within my network that I can introduce him to
yeah.
or whatever. But, you know, I know that what's going to come out of that.
Absolutely. And I'm like you, and I do that, and I'm always, my first thing with people that I'm connecting with is, so what can I do to help you?
Yeah.
What can I do to help you? Because
yeah. I'm going to share a funny example. So this gentleman that I was talking about that I connected with that called me yesterday and said, we want to hire you. This is what happened. We had our board meeting, the president, CEO, the stakeholders were all there, and they were everybody was giving their opinion on who they should hire for social media, and you know, I totally pushed you, whatnot. This guy, the way I met him was he had just recently gotten divorced about 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And my friend Andrew, who passed away last year, his family lived out of the province, and I knew that these two guys had nowhere to go for Christmas.
Oh.
I invited them to my house for Christmas. So this guy's first impression of me was, she was the girl that invited me to her house for Christmas and fed me this
yeah.
great meal when I didn't have anybody else.
Yeah.
Just an example of, you know, the whole relationship aspect and how important it can be and what it can ultimately leverage. 5 years later now, you know, I'm going to have probably a contract that's going to exceed six figures
yep.
from this one nice thing that I did, inviting somebody to my house for dinner for Christmas.
Yeah.
And, I mean, obviously, if I didn't have the credibility to back it up and whatnot, I would have lost that. But, you know what I mean? It's those real-life relationships. And this is what I do love about this, you know, this hangouts and video chat and stuff like that. If I could just get past the fact that I like to work in my pajamas sometimes. I like to put on makeup.
Guess what? We can do that.
Pajama pants on, right?
Yeah. From as some of the guys say in video chats, it's like, well, from the waist down, jammies and nothing, you know.
Yeah, so no, you're going to have to spend some time teaching me a little bit more about Google Hangouts.
Absolutely. I'm so happy to hear you say that, because you know I've been dying to do this since last year. The year before, no matter. You know, right from the beginning.
Yeah.
Anyway, we're going to start wrapping up now. This has been absolutely fabulous. Melonie, you are such a font of information and fabulous, fabulous information. Anybody, if you just implement one thing Melonie said today, I guarantee you are going to see changes on your LinkedIn profile. Having said that, what's one little tidbit you can offer, either personal or business, that people can implement right now today?
Okay, so I can't limit it to one.
Yay!
I can't limit it to one. But the first thing is, when you're thinking about your keywords that you want to optimize your profile for, make sure you're not thinking in terms of, you know, what you put on your website necessarily. Think about in terms of what your ideal clients might be looking for when they're looking for what you offer. So, for example, you know, somebody on LinkedIn might not be looking for a brand strategy for their company, right? Or a social media strategy for their company. They might be looking for a social media strategist or a brand strategist or a marketing specialist or a marketing consultant or something like that. So understand that when people are looking on LinkedIn, they're looking for people, not things a lot of times.
Absolutely.
Once in a while, they might type in things, and that's where all the other content in your profile comes into play, where you talk about all the things you do.
Right.
But what you really want to optimize your profile for with the primary keywords is who you are, the title.
Yes.
And so if you're an owner and founder, scrap that. I'm the owner and founder of Top Dog Social Media. Nowhere in my profile will you see that.
No.
What I'll say is that I'm a social media speaker, a social media consultant, a social media trainer, a LinkedIn expert. You know, those are the things that I am, because I know that those are the things people are looking for. They're not looking for the founder of Top Dog Social Media. So really think about that. The second thing is I talked earlier about, you know, making sure that your profile is really client focused, and that in your summary section, you know, you do have to start off with telling people a little bit of information about you. So give them what I call your credibility paragraph. Share a little bit of information about you, and then go right into who is it that you work with and how do you help them.
Yes, and start absolutely. To see
them so that when they read your profile, they can literally self-select. Yes. I also have a really handy little LinkedIn checklist that you can get, and you can download it so that you can print it off and have it next to your computer as you're working through your LinkedIn profile. It's LinkedInChecklist.com. Download that, and as you're working through your profile, you know, make sure that you're filling out all the different areas and optimizing all the different areas. So it's just a great little handy tool.
Oh, that's excellent. And Melonie, I will be sure and put that under this video on Business Banter Plus on the page with Melonie, so people can go there and get it later if they want to download it. Okay. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. I look forward to seeing you in the fall.
Yeah, absolutely. Me too.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
having another video chat.
I look forward to that even more. And now you can't say you haven't done Hangouts, so we'll be doing this again very, very soon. Thanks very much for tuning in, everybody. It's Elaine Lindsay with Business Banter Plus. Our next show is in 2 weeks. See you then. Bye-bye.